I'm going to introduce our annual lecturer, our RIP annual lecturer tonight. It's Rae Langton. Rae Langton was born in India to, I've got to put that in because so was I, and so it gives us, to Australian parents. She was educated, her high school education was in India, and she went on to complete a BA in Sydney. She moved to the United States for her PhD at Princeton. She's now Professor of Philosophy at Cambridge and Fellow of Newnham. Before moving to Cambridge in 2013, she was Professor of Philosophy at MIT, and before that was Professor of Moral Philosophy at the University of Edinburgh. She was elected to the American Academy of Arts and Science in 2013 and to the British Academy in 2014. She was one of Prospect Magazine's World Thinkers 2014, and in 2015 she gave the John Locke Lectures in Oxford. Despite attaining this extraordinary prominence and level of success, it tells you something about our speaker that when you go onto her website to find out these things, there's a significant paragraph detailing not just her career highlights, but her career lowlights. I'm not going to go through them, but I think it's sort of testament to her clear thinking, modesty, that it's there. Rae Langton's first book was called Kantian Humility, Our Ignorance of Things in Themselves. Modesty again there. This was followed by Sexual Solipsism, Philosophical Essays on Pornography and Objectification. Among her best known articles is Duty and Desolation, published by none other than the Royal Institute of Philosophy's journal, Philosophy. So there's something fitting that she's doing this lecture. She works, we all know, in moral and political philosophy, history of philosophy, metaphysics, philosophy of law, speech act theory, and feminist philosophy. In all these areas, Rae Langton's work is unusually powerful and compelling. I expect we'll see this tonight also when she gives the 20th Royal Institute of Philosophy annual lecture. I invite her to present her lecture, What is the Point of Immorality?
Immortality.
That's a Freudian slip.
Thank you very much, Lucy, and thank you very much all of you for being here. It's a tremendous honour to give this lecture, and as Lucy says, it does feel special because of the Royal Institute of Philosophy being where I published Duty and Desolation, which is a paper about Maria von Herbert, who I am still a tremendous fan of. Okay, so my paper today is venturing into somewhat new territory, and my title is not What's the Point of Immorality, it's What's the Point of Immortality. And there's, as you'll see, something slightly misleading about my title, but rather than apologise, I'll just let you see shortly why it is a bit misleading. I'm going to begin with a passage from Joyce, Portrait of the Artist as a Young Man. Because this passage captures something, a certain kind of self-projective imagining of an afterlife. Now, most people, when they think of immortality, are going to be thinking of a rather happy afterlife in which they will get to spend much time with God, or even better, their loved ones. But This afterlife that the young Joyce, I presume, since it's a portrait of the artist, is imagining is not that. So some of you who've read Portrait of the Artist will remember there's this extraordinary chapter 3 which discusses, no, it brings to life a retreat at which the 16-year-old hero is forced to confront the reality of hell in the most vivid way. And in fact, so is the reader, because at the retreat, day after day, the priest who's leading the retreat makes vivid different aspects of hell. The stench, the pain, the torture, the loneliness, the absence from God, the malicious devils. It builds up and builds up over an extraordinary series of pages. At this point, in fact, what I've done is somewhat cheating. I've put together two passages of two very salient days. So the 16-year-old hero has just listened to one of these hellfire sermons, and he is completely in a blue funk, as one of the other boys says. He had died. Yes, he was judged. A wave of fire swept through his body. The first, again a wave, his brain began to glow. Another, his brain was simmering and bubbling within the crackling tenement of his skull. Flames burst forth from his skull like a corolla, shrieking like voices. Hell, 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 hell. So that's the first. The next day there's another hellfire sermon, and here's his response to the next hellfire sermon. He has this vision of fiends and devils in this sort of desolate, deserted landscape full of thistles and dung and revolting. Anyway, the malice of evil glittered in the fiend's hard eyes, a rictus of cruel malignity. They moved in slow circles, circling closer and closer to enclose, soft language issuing from their lips, their long swishing tails besmeared with stale shite, thrusting upward their terrific faces. God had allowed him to see the hell reserved for his sins, stinking, bestial, malignant, a hell of lecherous, goatish fiends. For him, more exclamation marks. So this is one of the most vivid descriptions of hell I have seen. The only thing that comes near it was once when I was having breakfast with Philip Pettit and Mark Johnston in Canberra, and both of them had a Catholic upbringing as well, and they were outdoing each other. They were trying to outdo each other with hellfire sermons, which were close to this. So what do I want to say about this passage? So, well, one thing to say is that in case anybody is too offended about this, the reason I am interested in this topic is that I did believe in hell for many years, and I thought I was destined for it. And not many philosophers are in that position, but I was one. Immortality had its bad side as well as its good side, if we're thinking about its point. And I was one of those brought up not Catholic, but a fundamentalist Christian who lay awake at night. No wonder I got interested in speech acts, lying awake at night wondering, did I really or didn't I managed to invite the Lord Jesus into my heart? Oh, did it work? Did it work? Was it felicitous? Or did it misfire? You know, I didn't have the language for it then, but the idea of powerful speech acts on which your salvation might turn is very much there in the background. But I'm not talking about speech acts today or their power. I'm talking about immortality and its point. So in this passage from Joyce, what do we have? I'm calling it self-projective imagining of an afterlife. It's self-projective. By that I mean it has a certain kind of first personal character. And that character is first personal in two ways. I'm going to try and keep track of them, but this is actually drawing on distinctions to be found in the work of Zeno Wendler and Dilip Nainan and a number of people. And one of them is to be found also in David Lewis. And that's the distinction between knowledge de se and knowledge de dicto. So this is de se. De se is about yourself in a particular way, about yourself, as Frege would have said, under a certain mode of presentation. Lewis didn't put it that way. It was about, those of you who know the Lewis will remember, he imagined two omniscient gods, one on a mountain throwing down thunderbolts and the other on a mountain throwing down, I've forgotten what it was. But anyway, the point is they knew everything, but they didn't know which of the two gods they were, because de se knowledge, knowledge of which one, or knowledge of yourself, under that special mode of presentation was not accessible to them. So that's a big topic, the difference between de se knowledge, a special kind of self-ascription, and de dicto knowledge. All I want to say is this is an instance of de se imagining. It's de se imagining, imagining of oneself that such and such is happening. It's imagination, it's not belief, but it's de se imagining. It's imagining of himself. It's not imagining of Stephen under some de dicto description that happens to be him. It is imagining of himself. It's de se. It's also first personal, not only in the de se way, but in what I'm going to call from the inside way. Now, this terminology, from the inside, I'm picking up from Zeno Wendler. Wendler contrasts two different kinds of imagining, not looking at the de se, de dicto, looking at imagining from the inside and from the outside of the same situation. In the part of Wendler that I'm thinking of, two people are walking by a cliff, and one person says to the other, "Oh, imagine swimming in that water." They're looking down at the crashing waves below, it looks freezing. And Wendler observes that there are two ways I can obey this injunction to imagine myself swimming down there in those waves. I can have an imagining from the outside. I imagine myself swimming in that water. What does that mean? I picture myself, you know, as if I'm some third party looking out there. I picture myself being tossed about in the water, a scrawny body bobbing up and down in the foamy waste. So that's one kind of imagining as a kind of third personal picturing, but of oneself. So it is de se in that case that he's imagining, that he's talking about. It is of. So when I'm imagining myself in this from the outside way, I'm imagining that it's Rae and I know it's me. It's not under any opaque description. And I'm imagining it from some third personal point of view. Imagining from the inside is different. Imagining from the inside involves imagining swimming in that water, the cold, the salty taste, the tug of the current. What Wendler is trying to draw attention to is the idea that some of our imaginings have a very, they have a from the inside perspective. So I'm from the perspective of the person swimming in the water. I'm not, you know, from the vantage of the cliff looking down as if seeing myself down there in the icy waves. It's from the inside. I am in the water looking up maybe at the cliff. And it's full of all of this phenomenological richness because this time I'm really feeling, imagine feeling the cold. And so there's so much more phenomenology going on in the from the inside way of imagining. So now what I want to suggest is that this imagining of hell that we find in Portrait of the Artist as a Young Man is first personal in those in both of those two ways I've just distinguished. That is to say, it is de se, it is referring to him, it's referring to Stephen himself, not under some opaque de dicto description, but in the de se way. And it's a from the inside way, with all of the perspective of somebody who is in the situation, in this ghastly field surrounded by the thistles and the shite and the devils and all the rest of it, with all of the phenomenological vividness and richness that that brings. Now, I said this is going to be, my title is slightly misleading. My title is What's the Point of Immortality? My real question is not what's the point of immortality, but what's the point of this capacity we have, that this capacity that someone like Steve, like James Joyce has, or that Stephen, the character, has, rather, to imagine himself in this afterlife situation. I could have, you know, funny, I don't know why, I can never find descriptions of heaven that have the same vividness. A description of heaven would have done just as well, and in fact, if any of you know some descriptions of heaven that are as vivid as this description of this imagined anticipation of hell, please do let me know, because it's a bit bleak having to having to struggle through this. And of course, those of you who know the book know that the sermons, the Hellfire sermons, go on for pages and pages and pages. So you really are immersed in it in the way that Stephen, the character, is. So thinking of that imaginative achievement, it's first personal in the de-se way, it's first personal in the from the inside phenomenological way. Now, I want to comment on what's going on with this as an epistemic resource, or as an apparent epistemic resource. Of course, you might think imagination can't be any kind of epistemic resource, but some people think that imagining and conceiving are quite close to each other, and conceiving something is a way of finding out whether something is possible. We have Hume saying, it is an established maxim in metaphysics, this is my quotation number two, that whatever the mind clearly conceives includes the idea of possible existence, or in other words, that nothing we imagine is absolutely impossible. Notice that Hume there is talking interchangeably of imagining and conceiving. Many people will want to distinguish those. In fact, Descartes himself distinguished conceiving from imagining in the Meditations, and many people want to distinguish them for good reasons. Nevertheless, I'm not going to take the work to distinguish conceiving and imagining here, because both of them can seem to be sources of knowledge. Conceiving something and imagining something, whatever their close or not so close relationship, can be sources of knowledge, or apparently sources of knowledge. And what do we think about this particular imagining? To the young Stephen, it seems to reveal a possibility. More than just a possibility, in fact, it seems to reveal his destiny, given that he has, in fact, sinned horribly. And in fact, I didn't quote more of it. What happens at the end of this, of the second passage, is that he is so overcome, he gets up and vomits into his basin, and is completely overwhelmed physically as well as psychologically, and then eventually goes to confession. And anyway, I won't say, you'll have to read it for yourselves if you haven't already. It's an amazing work. There's apparent modal knowledge which seems at the very least to reveal a possibility. Moreover, there's apparent, and now here we have to keep track of our spellings again, there's apparent moral knowledge as well as modal knowledge, in that this very vivid imagining of this afterlife destiny seems to reveal what matters. It gives this acute awareness of sin, of pollution, of the woman he sinned with as being extremely polluting. By the way, there's all sorts of other things in the whole value system that this is all tied up with. So there seems to be this revelation of value, this revelation of what matters. And because of that, because it seems to reveal a possibility and because it seems to reveal structures of value, it is also extremely motivating. As I said, he not only vomits into his sink, he later goes to confession and gets back on good terms with God. So, what I've described is a kind of mental act of self-projective imagining of an afterlife. Now, I'm going to say that this is an imagining of an impossible self. I'm not going to give adequate argument for that, but it is impossible. It's not just contingently false. It's impossible that we could survive our deaths. I can say a little bit about that, but that is not the main theme of today. So when I ask the question, what is the point of immortality? I'm not saying, hooray, we have immortality, now what is it for? No, I'm thinking we have this capacity for imagining ourselves immortal or imagining ourselves as living beyond death. And that capacity has some very striking features. And what is the point of that capacity? That is actually my question. It was just too long to put on the title and nobody would have come. Anyway. Okay. So if you want me to speculate about the point of immortality, given that it doesn't exist, what I would have to do is speculate about the point of religious commitments to immortality? Is it wishful thinking? Is it about religions being the opiate of the people? There's a whole big question about what the point of it is under that heading, which I'm not going to address. I'm interested in the point of this capacity of imagining oneself immortal, because that is the imagining of an impossible self. I think this is very striking, especially if imagining, as Hume says, is exactly what seems to reveal possibility. What's going on there if we are, in this case, imagining something impossible? What's the point of it? What's the point of that? I'm really interested in that, partly because I was so in the grip of it myself for many years, and I think it does have a point. I'm interested to see if you will agree. Now, I'm going to suggest, and this part of the paper owes something to some argument by Mark Johnston in his very interesting and weird book, Surviving Death. I'm going to suggest that this imagining oneself into an afterlife is very easy for us to do for two reasons. He doesn't put it quite like this. Johnston doesn't put it quite like this, but I'm, maybe because I'm more of a fan of Descartes than him, I can't help but see it this way. So, one is the apparent necessity of, I'll just put it in the first person, of my own existence. It is really hard to imagine of oneself that one doesn't exist. There are all sorts of Berkeleyan issues about, you know, could you imagine an unperceived tree? Some of these things are in the background. The way Johnston puts it is, I'm coeval with the appearance and reappearance of the world. The whole world, as I see it, of course, it comes along with me. Johnston cites, I think, Heidegger in this connection, but I'm no Heidegger scholar, but he talks about how the self seems to be the fountain of all being. That's a very grand way to put a point which is at least touched on in the Cogito, in Descartes' Cogito, of course, although Descartes' Meditations has got a nice preface to all the religious leaders saying, I'm sure you're going to feel very pleased at the way I've been putting very important doctrines like the immortality of the soul and the existence of God on a firmer foundation. I'm not going to suggest that Descartes thinks that he has proved the immortality of the soul, but he has made some progress towards that, even in the Meditations. Now, the cogito in Meditation 2 can be put many different ways. One way to put it is in terms of a modal thesis that says something like, necessarily, if I think I exist, I exist. Now, that is a reconstruction. What Descartes actually says is the proposition, I am, I exist, is necessarily true whenever it is put forward by me or conceived in my mind. Now, of course, if it was necessarily true, then in the way that philosophers think that a proposition is necessarily true nowadays, what would that mean? It would mean that the proposition, I exist, is true in every possible world and couldn't fail to be true. That, of course, is not what Descartes means, even though his language suggests that. What he means, I think, is something like what I suggested, namely, if we are careful with the modal operator in this case, we don't say, we don't have anything whose conclusion could be I necessarily exist. We have the necessity operator out the front, necessarily, if I think I exist, or something like that. So what that means is there is a kind of unthinkability about one's non-existence, but that's because as soon as you're thinking anything at all, your existence is there. There's lots more to say about the Meditations. I want to say one more thing, which is that the cogito was, or something like it, was anticipated in an argument from an Indian philosopher, an Advaita Vedanta philosopher called Shankara, and I was so pleased when I found this, though you might think I'm reading into it. Shankara writing in the, I believe, the 9th century, so well before the Meditations, drawing on a Cartesian theme, or what we think of as a Cartesian theme, the Descartes came much later, the irrefutability of the existence of the self. This is how Shankara puts it. Just because it is the self, it is impossible for us to entertain the idea even of its being capable of refutation. And to refute such a self-established entity is impossible. And as the nature of the self is eternal presence, it cannot undergo destruction even when the body is reduced to ashes. Isn't that splendid? Do you see? This is a really exciting conclusion. From something like the cogito, Shankara is concluding that the self, I think, necessarily exists. And if the self necessarily exists, it couldn't go out of existence. So it's not going to be reduced to ashes. When the body is reduced to ashes, it's going to keep existing. So we get from something like a cogito starting point a conclusion that is close to immortality. That's the Hindu, the Advaita Vedanta doctrine about the immortality of the Atman or soul. Even more excitingly, and I haven't quoted this bit, once you've found out that you're the necessary being, who are you? Atman, the individual soul, is also God. So the Atman is Brahman. The individual soul is also God. So from this thing that's like a cogito, you get a conclusion about the necessary existence of the self, which first of all means it's immortal, and then divine. How amazing. Unfortunately, the bad news is, this is a possible diagnosis. I'm sorry to be boring. My possible diagnosis is a traditional modal scope error. So that little necessity operator has slipped into the wrong place, which is very easy to do. Some people, Paul Geyer thinks that's what Kant's whole philosophy rests on, a modal mistake of this kind. So think of the difference between what I ascribe to Descartes, necessarily, if I think I exist, and if I think I exist, I necessarily exist. Wow! from the latter, but not the former, you get a conclusion, once the antecedent is in place, of necessary existence. So that would be exciting, but unfortunately, we don't get that. What I want to say is that the cogito, and not just the cogito, because I don't think that all the things that Johnston was talking about and maybe that Heidegger were talking about, I don't think it's exactly the same as the cogito. What they do is make it very hard to countenance non-existence. They make it very tempting to conclude that one cannot fail to exist. And I believe this is not just a philosophical point. I think it's extremely shocking to any, at least I don't want to overgeneralize, I think it's very shocking to a child to suddenly realize, what, there was a time when I wasn't around? What, the time before my parents even met? How could that be? So there's a kind of natural, there's something solipsistic about it too, because it's as if, you know, I am the source of the world and what could there else have been? That tempting thought about the necessity of one's existence makes it hard to countenance a future non-existence. So that's the first thing, the apparent necessity of my existence. The second thing that makes it, that feeds into this, is the apparent contingency of my association with this body or even this human being. It seems imaginable that my existence, that I could exist apart from this body. Now we're talking about Meditation 6 and the argument for the real distinction between the mind and the body. It's that's normally put in terms of conceivability. It seems conceivable that my mind could exist apart from my body and vice versa. So it's imaginable that could exist without this particular body, perhaps without anybody, and perhaps independently of this particular human being. Now that Descartes doesn't get into that, but I think something like the argument for the real distinction gets us there as well. I'll say a bit more about that in just a minute. So what we have then, putting together this apparent necessity of my existence with the apparent contingency of my association with a particular body or any body or even this particular human being, when you put those together, you get a very tempting combination. It's hard to countenance a future non-existence because of the first thing, and it's easy to countenance a future existence in exotic forms associated with a different body or with no body or even with a different human being. So what does this mean? It means that it is easy to imagine an impossible self. It's easier than it should be to imagine an impossible self. So I can engage in this self-projective imagining of an afterlife in which I imagine myself as immortal, as existing after death. Now, I haven't said why that's an impossible self. I believe it's impossible for anyone to survive their death. And the reason for that rests on what I could be and what you could be and what any of us could be. So in order to address that adequately, we would need to make a quite complex excursion into personal identity, and what is it that makes you the same as the baby you were, and what is it that couldn't possibly make you the same as any being who lived after your death. A big section of Johnston's book on surviving death looks at every possible candidate view. The view that, obviously, the view that you're identical with your body is a non-starter, because that's going to be burnt up in the ashes if you're going to be cremated, as Shankara thought. Lockean and neo-Lockean views won't work either. And of course, the best candidate, namely that there is a Cartesian soul, That won't work either because the soul, as described, is not something that is you. Now, I haven't said enough about that, and I'm going to just leave it as a promissory note. And I actually don't have anything to add apart from what Johnston says in this section of his book. I agree with him that on every account of a person, apart from the one that he himself ends up endorsing at the end, there is no way of surviving one's death. Okay, so we've got this really interesting, tempting combination, which allows ourselves, which allows me to project myself into an imagined future, an imagined post-mortem future, in a way that is actually impossible, despite Hume's claim that what we can imagine, we always attribute, we always say is possible. So, we have then a modal illusion associated with a very tempting combination. Now, I want to compare this modal illusion of projecting oneself into an impossible future self, this projecting imagination of an afterlife. I want to compare it with a different impossible self projection. Compare it with a self-projective imagining of another person's life. So instead of Stephen Dedalus imagining himself existing after his death with those fiends, he imagines himself existing as one of his friends, or as a priest, or someone else he knows. Now, that is a very different thing, and it's also something that we seem very readily to be able to do. Johnston describes this imaginative power as auto-alienation. Auto-alienation is the power to imagine that you were somebody completely different, a specified completely different other person. David Lewis also talks about this, and he has a very nice description about how this imaginative feat seems to imply that it is possible for me to have been somebody else. In fact, this is why I think we have more at stake than simply the possibility of not being associated with a particular body. We have the possibility of being an entirely different human being. Lewis puts it this way, here am I, imagining a conversation, here am I, there goes poor Fred, there, but for the grace of God, go I. How lucky I am to be me, not him. Where there is luck, there must be contingency. I am contemplating the possibility of my being poor Fred and rejoicing that it is unrealized. It's a very Lewis little passage, isn't it? So there but for the grace of God go I. How lucky I am to be me, not him. Where there is luck, there is something contingent. What I'm doing is contemplating the possibility of my being Fred and rejoicing that this possibility is not realized. So I seem to be able to imagine being some other completely different person. Now, is that possible? If Hume were right, our capacity to imagine being some completely different person reveals a possibility, or at least maybe it's fallible, maybe it's a guide to possibility, maybe there's some reason for thinking it's possible. What's going on there? I mean, to put it intuitively, you're sort of imagining that, you know, my window on the world could be sort of, you know, looking out at the world through, you know, those eyes instead of these eyes, or through from the point of view of that person rather than this person. So we seem to be able to imagine this very easily, and it maybe seems to imply a possibility. Again, I would suggest it does not. It does not. This is not possible. It is not possible for you to have been somebody else. It is not possible for me to have been somebody else. We are necessarily whoever we are. This answer is in harmony with something that Leibniz remarked, which I meant to put on the handout. Let's see if I can just remember it. So in response to somebody who says, I wish I were the King of France. If only I were the King of France instead of me, or something like that. Leibniz imagines somebody saying this. At a time, by the way, where there was a King of France. So let's not get muddled up with non-referential expressions. Leibniz says, what this person is wishing is that he should go out of existence and that there should be a King of France. That's all there is to it. There's nothing that it could be, says Leibniz, for that to be true. Now, for present purposes, I'm going to agree with Leibniz. To be honest, I harbor a lurking sympathy for the person who thinks, but it is possible for me to have been the King of France. And I don't just mean to have been crowned King of France. I mean, it is possible for me to have been that individual. It seems that the thought does not seem as incoherent as Leibniz makes it. For present purposes, I'm going to assume it is incoherent. And by the way, this is something that Bernard Williams discusses as well, and also thinks, like Leibniz, is incoherent. It's impossible for me to have been the King of France. What is going on then when I am imagining, and this is now Williams' example, when I'm imagining being Napoleon looking out on the battle after the Battle of Austerlitz? Bernard Williams asks us what's going on there. And he says, well, I'm imagining the scene of desolation as viewed by me. I'm imagining my hand in my waistcoat pocket and my three-cornered hat. And so we give some more and more content to the imagining. What's going on with that? It's not imagining that I am Napoleon. That wouldn't make any sense. There is no me in the picture at all. What it is something else. Now, what is that something else? One thing I want to say is that the imagining of being somebody else has some features in common with the imagining that I ascribed to Stephen Dedalus at the beginning. It has in common not just that it is the imagining of an impossible self. It has some other features too, and I'll spell that out in just a moment. Now, what I want to suggest, and what I've been suggesting so far, is that these imaginings, contrary to first appearances, do not give us modal knowledge, contrary to Hume on imagination, and contrary to what it feels as if they're doing. I want to suggest that the self-projection where we are projecting ourselves into an impossible self post-mortem, the same thing is going on when we're projecting ourselves into an impossible self, which is somebody else. In both cases, it's an imaginative projection into a situation which could not possibly be. So if it is not giving us modal knowledge, if it's not giving us knowledge of what is possible, what is it doing? Now, so this is my what's the point of it question. I'm going to suggest that its point is not modal knowledge, but moral knowledge. So the point of this capacity to project oneself imaginatively into the impossible self, it's about moral knowledge, not modal knowledge. So We have the phrase putting yourself into someone else's shoes. And the use of that phrase, putting yourself into someone else's shoes, is almost entirely in ethics. It's sometimes in little thought experiments like the sort that Williams discussed, but it's especially in ethics. And the point of it is that when we put ourselves in the shoes, just keeping it metaphorical for now, of somebody else, we find something out about how things are for them. And so what we find out is, what we can find out is what matters in general and what matters to them. I want to connect this imaginative capacity with something that Richard Hare says. I'm not sure how, with R.M. Hare, what's something that R.M. Hare says, and I'm not sure how far I want to go along with him on this. But he, more than anybody else, has talked about this capacity as a source of moral knowledge, and in fact, as a kind, as a very important aspect of moral reasoning. So my ninth quotation is from Hare. I missed the part about Adam Smith, who was describing empathy as well. Hare says, a certain power of imagination and a readiness to use it is a necessary ingredient in moral arguments. I have to know what it will be like for the person. We shall have to keep carefully in mind the distinction between knowing that something is happening to someone and knowing what it is like for them. It is the latter kind of knowledge which I'm proposing we should treat as relevant and as required for the full information which rationality in making moral judgments demands. And then from somewhere else, he's comparing A and B. This person B must be prepared to give weight to A's inclinations as if they were his own. That is what turns selfish prudential reasoning into moral reasoning. It is much easier psychologically for B to do this if he is actually placed in a situation like A's vis-a-vis somebody else, but this is not necessary provided that he has sufficient imagination to envisage what it is like to be A. Now, Hare is talking about the use of imagination in moral reasoning, where its use involves the gaining of knowledge of certain what it's like facts for other people. I want to suggest that what he is describing has a lot in common with the self-projective imagining that I was ascribing, that I was describing right at the outset, that was what Stephen Dedalus is doing. What Hare is describing is a kind of first personal imaginative projection that is, in a certain sense, though this is actually a bit controversial, it is in a certain sense de se. Now, it's not strictly de se, because if I'm putting myself in your shoes, it's okay, there is something about me that is being put into your shoes, and that's the say of the de se. I am not doing justice to this. This is very, very hard to do justice to, this part. But I want to suggest that there is something of imaginative self-projection that involves the one's own, that involves the say, the self of the day say, projected into somebody else. And that's what's captured in the metaphor of putting oneself into others, into the shoes of another. I also want to point out that Hare keeps mentioning the what it's like for the other person. He keeps insisting that there is a certain kind of knowledge that you can only get from this kind of imaginative engagement. The knowledge of what it's like facts for other people. What I want to suggest is that what he's talking about is an imaginative engagement that is not only de se, projecting a self into somebody else, it is also from the inside rather than from the outside. That is to say, you know, remember I contrasted not only de dicto and de se at the beginning, I also contrasted from the outside and from the inside ways of having first personal imaginings. So you can have an imagining that is first personal in a from the outside way, and you can imagine things from the point of view. You can put yourself in someone's shoes without that kind of vivid phenomenological engagement. But when you do it with the vivid phenomenological engagement, that's in a from the inside way, where you are understanding better what the world looks like and what matters to that other person. Now, so we have it's first personal in the dei-sei way, first personal in the from the inside way. I talked about already how it seemed this capacity seems to go along with a kind of modal knowledge. Oh, I could have there, but for the grace of God go I. I could have been them. That, I'm suggesting, is an illusion, but you do get moral knowledge. You get knowledge about what matters actually generally, and also what matters to them. And you get motivation. This is the key role for hair. You get knowledge and you get motivation. Knowledge and motivation are the two gifts that imaginative self-projection gives to the moral agent, according to Hare. He unpacks it in terms of this idea of you know, this knowledge being enough to make you form what he calls actual for possible desires. Not only do I understand what matters to you and understand what you want, I want for myself, were I in that situation, to be treated in such and such a way. So I'm not going to defend actual for possible desires. I think that's interesting. I'm agnostic about whether that's where we should go. All I want to point out is that regardless of whether you go there with R.M. Hare, the idea that empathy can be a source of knowledge and a source of motivation of others is a familiar one, and it has an empirical side as well. The empirical studies were done by Batson and his colleagues, and my favorite part was in the altruism studies that Batson's team did, where, for instance, subjects in the study had to engage with another person who, of course, was a Confederate, but they didn't know that. Their instructions as to how to engage with the person were empathy flattening or empathy promoting. So here are the words that were used to promote or flatten the empathy. Read the information in the communicator's notes carefully, trying to take the perspective of the individual writing the notes. Try to imagine how this individual feels about what he or she writes. So that's the instruction is try and take the perspective of the agent. The other set of instructions were clinical. Read the information in the communicator's notes carefully, trying to be as objective as possible. That's all. And then Batson and his team tracked helping behavior. Okay, the first condition was the condition under which people helped strangers, and the second condition wasn't. I think that's quite interesting, given how much we like priding ourselves on objectivity, which we should. Objectivity is good, but I'm getting distracted by the objectivity thing. What I most want to say is that the self-projection that I'm talking about can be a source of moral knowledge, and what that means is the capacity which gets us to our immortal selves, that capacity yields modal illusions, whether about ourselves or whether about others, but it also yields moral knowledge. By the way, it's not that I think empathy is the cure to all ills. In fact, Richard Holton and I have a paper which is all about the limits of empathy and how empathy doesn't get you nearly far enough. Why? Because we just saw, empathy works better the more similar you are to the person you're empathizing with, and the more dissimilar the person is, the harder the empathy is. This, by the way, is where all kinds of background conditions, including the social conditions for empathy, are relevant to whether or not we are able to take to adequately take the viewpoint of others, whether we indulge in pseudo-empathy and project ourselves in an oversimplistic way, whether we don't even think of the other states of mind at all. And then there will be cases where empathy is completely impossible. And what Richard and I were talking about was actually empathy and animal ethics, where empathy is actually impossible, but that doesn't mean our obligations run out by any means. So, I've been wanting to talk about the point, not strictly speaking of immortality, but about our capacity to imagine ourselves immortal. And my question is, what is the point of that capacity to imagine an impossible self? And now I'm going to put it to you that the point of that capacity is not at all about modal knowledge. It's not at all about our immortal souls. It's about moral knowledge, and it's about each other. Thank you.